Slum 1200 GGI Mob, and I'm back. Slum 1200 GGI Mob, and I'm back. Slum 1200 GGI Mob, and I'm back. Back. GGI Mob shit, and I'm back. So we gonna be going to Jamaica with it. We gonna be talking about Kenneth Skeeng Don Black. He will be labeled as one of the top three biggest drug dealers in Jamaica. And he will also be somewhat of a politician. If it came down to being the best, that claim would not go to Frank Matthews, whom fate is unknown to this day. If there is such a thing as the best of all time, black drug dealer, that title would go to no one other than Jamaican businessman Kenneth Black, aka Skeeng Don, who fed a lot of hustlers from Miami to New York City as well as London from his home base in Jamaica, and who spent the bulk of his life assimilating from his past life as a well-respected coke don of the Spangler's posse in the 1980s into a legit politician, lobbyist, and businessman who receives hundreds of millions of dollars in contracting fees from his construction business, which constructs housing developments for the poor and working class in Jamaica. He even won a $200 million judgment against the former prime minister of Jamaica for slandering him as a gangster during an interview with a Jamaican newspaper.
The past few months, we've been hearing and seeing more about illegal drug trafficking than ever before. Despite the Reagan administration's war on drugs, it seems as though every week there's a new country, indeed a new U.S. ally, reportedly involved in shipping cocaine here. But what we rarely see is the connection between governments and their political motives in dealing with the drug problem. Tonight, we get an unusual glimpse into why the war on drugs is failing. Jamaica is one of this country's closest friends and favored trading partners. We give Jamaica more U.S. aid than any other Caribbean country. We also export a voracious appetite for drugs. So, Jamaican organized crime is flooding this country with tons of cocaine and marijuana. And along with the drugs, Jamaican gangs, or posses as they're called, have imported a brand of cruelty that's second to none.
It's got move! It's got move! Good man, it's got! It's got!
This is the Jamaican connection most local police know. In Boston, in Miami, in Washington, D.C., Jamaican gangs are known to be responsible for at least 800 murders around the country. The horror is overwhelming. In January, five people were shot execution style, one after another, in suburban Washington. A sixth survived. Even in Kansas City, the bloody war is being fought in the neighborhoods. The newest enemy is the Jamaican crack dealer. He seems to be everywhere, operating 24 hours a day with vicious efficiency.
What is your name?
It all started with violence, with homicide. We had picked up intelligence information early in 1985 that we had a group of Jamaican nationals in Kansas City pushing a new substance to us, being crack, cocaine.
Dave Barton is the commander of a combined federal and local task force formed specifically to fight Jamaican posses.
What kind of money are you talking about? What kind of cash flow?
We figure a conservative estimation, one that doesn't seem so outrageous, would be anywhere from $150,000 to $250,000 a day.
In cash?
In cash, in the metropolitan area.
So you're talking about several million dollars a week?
That's right.
Is it staying in Kansas City?
No, it's not.
Where's it going?
Miami, New York, Jamaica.
This is the Jamaica the tourists never see. And here in the war on drugs lies the Jamaican connection with Kansas City, a connection few understand. Waterhouse, the neighborhood in Kingston from which the Kansas City posse takes its name and its members. The gang has shared political control of this area for years. Almost half the young men who grow up here will never have a steady job. The only career choice for many of them is membership in the gang.
We here in Waterhouse are afraid. We're the ones where the gunmen are running wild.
Father Richard Albert has been a priest in Waterhouse for 5 years. His church lies near the border of two rival gang territories. They've turned his parish into a battleground.
We have raids come back and forth. Saturday night, I put my head on my pillow at 10 to 10, and I heard heavy, heavy gunfire. Heavy gunfire. This morning, I got up to take the young kids off for a swim, and there was pistol fire out on the street.
Some of the guns in the neighborhoods like Waterhouse come from the posses in the United States. Here's how it works. The posses use their profits from the sale of drugs to purchase high-powered weapons, like these taken in raids in Kansas City. They then smuggle the guns to Jamaica, where they are used to control the neighborhoods through violence, intimidation, and murder.
The gun is seen as a weapon, as part of the baggage that goes into a political campaign. We're going to wreck everything unless we stop that.
Ronald Thwaites is a prominent Kingston attorney and political commentator. He hosts Jamaica's most popular daily radio talk show called Public Eye.
There must be this relationship between the so-called posses abroad and the local communities and the political aspirations within those communities. There isn't any other way for the guns to come in. Look, the guys who are being arrested, who are being shot down by the police, who are walking on the street corner with their guns, they have no source of foreign exchange. They have no basis, no earnings on which to pay out hundreds, indeed thousands of Jamaican dollars to get a gun. Somebody is giving them that. Somebody is giving them that for a purpose, for a cause.
The ultimate cause in Jamaica is political power. For 40 years, Jamaican elections have been bitter and violent. The last time the two main parties met to elect a prime minister was 8 years ago, when armed gangs aligned themselves with both parties, helping them consolidate their control of neighborhoods. Those are the same gangs who are now showing up in American cities dealing drugs. Because of their brutality in 1980, Kingston was called the Beirut of the Caribbean. Two men have held political power here for nearly two decades. Socialist Michael Manley of the People's National Party was defeated in the 1980 election by Edward Seaga, who is the current prime minister and favorite of the Reagan administration. Seaga was the first head of state to be received by President Reagan after his election. He's an astute politician who says the violence of 1980 will not be repeated. But in the neighborhoods, you hear a different story. They are still sharply divided into highly charged political territories enforced by posses loyal to the parties. And no wonder. For the people of these ghettos, there is more at stake than just who will be the next prime minister.
What does it mean if you come out on the wrong end of the election, if your party loses? What's that mean to people here?
What it means, basically, often, is victimization. The area is victimized. They need lights, they don't get no lights. The road has to be done, they don't get no road.
Strictly patronage.
Patronage, I use a stronger term, victimizing. They almost, in a sense, punish them for being laborite or being socialist.
This year, there will be a rematch between Edward Seaga and Michael Manley. Jamaican police admit that more guns have flooded the island now than in 1980 when these pictures were taken. Guns that many Jamaicans are afraid will be used to intimidate voters. U.S. attorneys and investigators, and indeed captured posse members, say that the guns are just one product of the millions of dollars in American drug sales that they believe will play a major role in the upcoming Jamaican campaign.
The money that is coming into Jamaica is coming in from outside Jamaica. It's being sold in the United States, and there is money coming into Jamaica.
No, sir.
Not true.
Not true.
The posse's in the United States have no influence.
You are confusing different things. The main drug dealers and drug barons are not posse people. They're people who would pass for businessmen. The profits that are made are never come back to Jamaica. It's all in your country, not in mine. Now, posses have nothing to do with that level of operation. To the extent that they are sending any money back to Jamaica, is the same category of Jamaican migrants who go abroad and work decently and earn their living and through their own prosperity send money back to Jamaica to their families.
When you talk to prosecutors, law enforcement people, judges in the United States, it's very clear that a large influx of weapons are coming into Jamaica. Hundreds of thousands, millions of dollars coming into Jamaica from the drug trade in Kansas City, New York, Miami. Where's that money going and where are those guns going?
Well, the one thing that I can tell you about the money is it's not going to the political party system. Well, I speak for my party and I know that.
Among the contributions the parties get are contributions from drug sources.
Arnold Bertram was a minister of information in the last opposition PNP administration. He's now retired from politics and writes political commentary.
Because violence is so intertwined with politics in this country, mm-hmm. when you come to the next election, is it the party that has the most muscle, the party that has the most guts?
It's a decisive factor. The party that comes to the elections with the most money and the most, and consequently, because it's impossible to buy muscle without plenty of money, hold a decisive card. The other big source of money are drug barons. Drug barons who give money to political parties do so on the basis that they expect something in exchange. And most obviously it must be that the government of the day will turn a blind eye to the operations which make the contributions possible.
We have made it absolutely clear. I speak constantly about it. There are constant instructions about it in the PNP that we do not wish to be penetrated or associated with gunmen, that we do not wish and that we intend to fight this thing.
Michael Manley, in his bid for prime minister, is now leading in the polls.
If I'm in Waterhouse and I'm a guy who's got $100,000, $200,000, $300,000, I've got guns, and you're a politician in that neighborhood, how can you not do business with me if you want to influence that neighborhood?
I tell you this, I'm a politician and no power. There is no power known to mankind that will make me deal with a man of that kind. I just won't do it.
If I'm a politician in that neighborhood, do I not have to know the people who have influence in that neighborhood? And if I am a drug baron and
The politician is concerned with people of influence in various areas and categories. The church has influence. The teachers have influence. The security forces have influence. Local community leaders have influence. True. To the extent that there are persons who have drug connections that have influence, they are there, but they are one of many.
Jamaica. That's as close to an admission as one can get from Siaga that the party has no choice but to deal politically with drug barons. He denies that his party takes drug money, but accuses his opponent's party, the PNP.
There's been one notable instance in which one of the leading drug barons actually made a donation on the floor of the conference of the PNP, which was accepted.
And who is that man?
No, I wouldn't like to call names of individuals. If you want to research it, you'll find it.
I know who the man is. Yeah. But you're saying this man is a drug dealer.
Oh, he's known, very well known.
How do you know that?
We know that. All intelligence knows that.
No question.
No question. Absolutely no question. He's not a drug dealer, a baron.
There's no question in your mind that Kenneth Black is a drug dealer, a drug baron.
Well, you said it, I didn't.
But you're saying to me that that person is a documented drug baron.
No question about that.
This is Kenneth Black. He's made a farce of the Reagan administration's war on drugs. Not only does the Jamaican Prime Minister call him a drug baron, but the Drug Enforcement Administration has had him under investigation for months. Posse members tell us that he's a major supplier of several U.S. cities, yet he's never been convicted or even arrested. He travels freely between the U.S. and Jamaica. Officials say he spent millions on businesses and property in both countries, and he's made no secret of his interest in the upcoming election.
You had a major contributor whom you honored. $100,000 contribution to the party. At least it was said it was $100,000. Do you remember?
Yeah, I remember. It was very open. He brought it up in a great big box.
And his name?
Not honored. I wouldn't remember his name. I just remember seeing a guy arrive with a box of money and dump it down.
Kenneth Black.
Is that it? But I wouldn't even
remember. You don't remember?
No, I don't know if I ever particularly knew his name. I may have known it, but I don't remember the name.
But he, in fact, gave
a substantial amount of money to the party?
No, I'll tell you. He came with a box that contained $100,000. He put it down and he turned to the platform and he said, "That is what I think of Siaga's government." And he walked in a bold, braggadocio way off the thing. I turned to my colleagues and I remember saying, "Who is that? Let me just straighten you out. Okay. No colleague of mine, no friend of mine, no associate of mine. Let's put that on the record."
Is there any doubt in your mind that both the JLP, Siaga's party, mm-hmm. and PNP, mm-hmm. Manley's party, mm-hmm. that both operate with drug money? No question.
There's no doubt at all to my mind that both parties get contributions from that source.
Arnold Bertram, like many Jamaican political analysts, believes that drug barons with their guns and money have become so entwined with the neighborhood politicians of both parties that they now desperately need one another to survive.
Once drug barons have got themselves in a position where they can become brokers, the politicians either have to try to wipe them out or make a deal with them. I don't think there are any alternatives.
And here?
And there's no evidence that they are succeeding in wiping them out.
My squad will take the lead. Inman and Foster will initially run up the stairs to the door. We're interested in apartment number 4 first. That's the active apartment tonight.
Back in Kansas City, members of the special task force are still fighting the battle, fighting the Jamaicans to a standstill. But there is no doubt that they are losing the war, because it's clear that they are fighting miles from the real front.
Drug trafficking is an international activity. It's an activity that takes place between countries. In this case, we're talking about Jamaica and the United States. If Jamaica has the means of putting an end to drug trafficking, the United States has that means even 100-fold more. From the fact that drug trafficking continues to take place at an even increased pace, I understand, means that there's an absence of political will in both countries to put a stop to it.
Skeeng Dine, as he is infamously called, also was a prominent figure in the dancehall reggae scene when started owning the sound system known as Stereo Mars, which eventually became an infamous label known as Skeeng Dine, which he moved from its original home in Kingston, Jamaica, on up to Miami in the early 80s, and its final destination in New York City, which gave birth to the careers of some of the most celebrated stars of dancehall today, and put out many of these classics for distribution. So he would be a prominent figure in Jamaica, and right now to this day still is well respected in Jamaica and talked about. And his name would be Skeeng Dine, Kenneth Skeeng Dine Black. You know what I'm saying? Y'all get in that comment section, hit that like button, make sure the notifications turned on, hit that subscribe button, and stay plugged. I'll be right back. Slum 1200, GGI Mob shit.
I ride around with the mop, that's a stick. 33 shots in the Glock, that's a dick. 50 round drum, call that bit 50 cent. 100 round drum on the Drake, it's a hit. It ain't no question, you play, you get hit. Pull up and let the bitch pray to that seat. Then I go pray, ask the savior for strength. I'm in creator, the savior, I'm him. Shout out the gates, we break winners like him. I told my son I'ma get us a M. I'ma keep grinding, I do it for them. No DJ Kelly, but I'm trying to win. Stand on that business, yeah, I get it in. They second line behind you and your kin. Riding that farm, you know that it's tenant. I got 100, my bro got the 50. Born in the slums, I was raised in the trenches. Be your nigga turn status a witness.